Welcome, everyone. My name is Colin McClay. I'm from the Berkman Center, and I am absolutely thrilled to be here with you all to celebrate Ethan and this amazing book. This has been a long time coming, and I feel like it's been, you know, sort of a marathon and then some. Let me just say, it has been worth the wait. So we'll get a taste of that tonight, beginning with some remarks from Ethan that will hopefully entice you to go out there and buy a copy of this book from the Coop, 20% off. You got a deal. Ethan might even autograph it for you. After Ethan gives his remarks, we'll dive into three very special respondents, Judith Donath, Anne-Marie Wilkins, and Lipinski, sorry, my other Anne-Marie, Anne-Marie Lipinski, my other Anne-Marie friend, and David Weinberger. And then we'll engage you guys in a spirited discussion of what this book means and what you've heard up here tonight. So what you see on here is, let's see, this will only give you a little teeny sense. It's kind of a little bit of a map, a Twitter map. Ethan loves maps, as you may know, or you'll find out. Partly because of what they show and partly because of what they don't show. And this shows some sort of connections among people, like blanket, and some of the terms and hashtags used by people who are interacting with each other, the Berkman Center, Ethan, me, and Get Rewired, which is the hashtag for this book. So right here, you can see kind of a little bit of the map as of now, activity over the last hours. And what we want to do is, over the course of this conversation, to encourage you to tweet with Get Rewired, something about Ethan Z, at Ethan Z, which is Ethan's Twitter handle, and see if we can populate this map and show some other kinds of connections and some other kinds of conversations. I do want to let you know that we are being webcast and recorded, so this is public. If for some reason you don't want to be on camera, that's quite okay. Just, we would encourage you to go to the back row here in front of the camera so as to be off camera. I think that's kind of what I need to say in terms of business. And I just want to, without waxing poetic on my love for my dear friend Ethan, I do want to note that although we'll talk about the book, I think what is even more amazing than the thoughtful scholarship and artful storytelling that he has brought together in a very natural, readable, thoughtful, and remarkable way, is the way in which he did it and the way in which he operates, which is as a tremendously committed, generous, genuine colleague. And to those of us, some of whom are here tonight, who wrote with Ethan in the book club, and to those of us who work with him at the Berkman Center and at MIT and in all the different places, all the different communities that Ethan populates, what comes up time and again is not just his intellectual insights, his energy, his positivity, but it's also his humanity and his colleaguery, which is something that is altogether too rare in academic settings. And so I think in this way, he really does set a remarkable example for all of us about how to do quality scholarship and to do it with people and people in mind, and every bit as committed to his own work as to those of the folks that he works with. So with that, I want to invite Ethan to come to the dais, to the podium, and take us away.
Thanks so much, man. You just tab in. Yep, we'll just tab our way over. So Colin, thank you so much. And I just wanted to start by thanking really two groups of people. And the first group of people I wanted to thank was you guys for coming out. And I sort of mean that maybe in perhaps a deeper sense than just thank you for coming out on a really hot, sweaty night. But this is my first book, and something that I absolutely didn't realize until I had it in print and was sending it out to people is the extent to which a book is an imposition on someone else's time. You give someone a book, and you're basically saying, I would really like you to spend 10 to 15 hours with this thing. I hope you don't mind. I realize you probably weren't doing anything this weekend. Here, please take this and do something with us. So the first thing I just want to say on all of this is thank you to anybody who reads. It's a pretty incredible thing to put this out in the world and have people reacting to it and have people who've read it thoughtfully It's an incredible honor. I'm really grateful for it. The second group of people I want to thank, starting with Colin McClay, are the Berkman Center. And I have a very strange path to what I do today. I work now, I'm lucky enough to be a research scientist at MIT's Media Lab and run a group called the Center for Civic Media. And there's absolutely no chance I would be doing any of that unless I had come to the Berkman Center about 10 years ago. And the reason for that was that I hadn't written. I was a dot-com startup guy, had an early social media company, had done some experiments in the nonprofit world, but hadn't tried writing. And Berkman has an incredible culture around believing that everybody who's at the center, whether they're the loftiest of research fellows or whether they're staff people working on administrative matters, has something to share and something to put out there, and whether it's through blogs or whether it's through scholarship. So I'm incredibly grateful because Berkman basically trained me how to write, right down to the moment where for the last 4 years or so, we've had a group called the Book Club. And the Book Club is basically a mechanism designed to try to help people get books out the door. I think it's mostly David Weinberger's invention. He is someone who is very good at getting books out the door, but was sort of kind enough to share his expertise with a sort of a dozen or more of us who've come in and out of this, trying to help us get our book length projects out the door. And some wonderful things have come out of it. David's last book, Doc Searles' recent book, Judith Donath's upcoming book, wonderful things sort of coming out of this. So I'm very, very grateful to Berkman. With those thanks said, let me start by talking a little bit about where I'm trying to go in this book. And the idea behind having three respondents here is that we know that you guys haven't read the book. And so I will try to give you a basic overview, and then these three, who I hope actually have, mostly because David and Judith helped me write the darn thing by, you know, sort of lording it over me for a couple of years until I got it out the door, they can also react to it, and we can have a conversation about it. But I want to start actually by talking about some ideas that I didn't manage to get into the book. And these are ideas about how we look at images of the world. So the image that we've had up here, mostly because it's really beautiful, is an image that's commonly referred to as the blue marble. And it's a remarkable image. It's in the first photographic image we have showing the entire world at the same time, shot from orbit, shot by the Apollo 17 crew. There are many arguments out there that this is the most circulated image of all time. There are arguments out there that this image, in a very literal sense, helped spawn the environmental movement, or at least acted as a rallying cry for people who were interested in this idea that the planet was unified, singular, interconnected, and fragile, and that by having this image that we could look at, we could suddenly understand in a much deeper way our responsibility to each other to try to act as stewards of this place. And this is an idea that resonates really well with me because, like a whole lot of other scholars out there, I found this book by Benedict Anderson incredibly helpful. And Anderson tries to do something fairly straightforward. He's interested in this question of what's a nation. And he ends up giving the fairly obvious observation that a nation can't be the bonds between individual people because we do not know the other 300 million people that we share the United States with. A nation, to one extent or another, has to be imagined. And we imagine ourselves as part of something bigger by looking at certain objects and certain artifacts. And Anderson's really interested in newspapers. He makes this argument that print capitalism, the fact that we can pick up the New York Times, or in his example, the Times of London, is what makes you British. By being able to say, I can imagine everybody else who's reading this newspaper at the same time, I can imagine England. And he's really interested in maps, these maps of empire. When we look at a map and we see all the pink places on the map, that's how we get ourselves to imagine what it is to be English, to imagine what it is to be part of this empire. So I started this book sort of with this question of, how do we imagine ourselves as part of the internet? And as Colin mentioned, I'm completely obsessed with maps. And I spent probably 10 years using this slide in every talk I gave. At that point, I was focused on working on technology in the developing world. And this is a really powerful and profound image if you're thinking about how technology works in parts of the world where most people don't think about technology. So by having a compound photograph of the Earth at night, you get a sense for just who is and who is not included in the wired world. And what's interesting is that this image is now totally out of date. If you got a current image, you would see a lot more of Africa electrified. You would probably not see this sort of stark disparity. But many of us still use this image because it has something very poetic to say about who gets to be connected and who doesn't get to be connected. But there might be other better maps. Here's a map of the spread of SARS. And SARS is an amazing disease of globalization. It's actually really hard to imagine, if you weren't directly involved with it, the level of panic of people who felt like they were exposed to SARS, because it had an incredibly high mortality rate, and you suddenly had this disease that no one had ever heard of before, spreading from southern China through Hong Kong, showing up in Toronto, and doctors essentially saying, we do not know where this is coming from, we don't know where it's going, but we're able to figure out over time that what SARS really is a map of connections. It's a map of how different human beings are connected to one another. We can think about maps like this. People move in. This is a map of migration. Where do people move from? What countries do they come from? Where do they end up in? It's a gorgeous visualization of people moving around the globe. We could go over to the Media Lab. Leo Benani done gorgeous work on a product called Source Map, which tries to ask us about the physical objects in our world. Where do they come from? This laptop that I'm presenting on. What are the components of it? Where are they made? How do they come together? And the message that's coming out of all of these maps are that we are deeply connected in one fashion or another. We're connected by the undersea cables that make up the internet that tie us back and forth. And ultimately, we're connected by personal links. We're connected by friendships. We're connected by relationships. And this is a map that I've spent a lot of time worrying about. This is a map. It was produced by an intern at Facebook. His name is Paul Butler. And this is one of those sort of dream jobs. You come into Facebook and Facebook says, here's all of our data. What would you like to do with it? And Paul Butler said, well, I'd really like to figure out who's friends with whom. And when you put it up on a map, you end up with this gorgeous sort of connected map that sort of suggests we're all linked to each other in one fashion or another, or at least to me that's what it sort of says at first glance. And then it's worth looking a little bit further because actually we're not all connected to one another. If you start looking, you'll start seeing, first of all, China's just gone. Doesn't exist at all. You know, at this point, China's blocking Facebook. You simply can't see it. You have the dark parts of the globe that you have on the NASA map, because the NASA map is really, in many ways, a map of an electrified population. But you also have some other missing things. It turns out that Russia's pretty much missing from this map. They're not big Facebook fans. They tend to use something called VKontakte. But the other thing besides this is that this is a map that's trying to demonstrate international connection. And that may not actually be what we're getting through something like Facebook. So one of the things that I wrestled with in this book was actually trying to get data sets out of Facebook. And I found people in Facebook who wanted to work with me and were wonderful. And I found Facebook's lawyers who were not so wonderful. And we were able to get some of the data out, but one of the things that we ended up finding was that the average person on Facebook has about 14% international ties. The average person on Facebook has about 130 friends. 14% of them on average cross national borders of one fashion or another, which you look at them and you go, that's amazing, that's fantastic. What an incredible technology to sort of knit us all together. And then you dig into it a little bit and you discover that that 14% includes a student who's studying from abroad here at Harvard and who is mostly tied to people at home, so their ties are 90% international. It counts the Pakistani worker who's working in the United Arab Emirates. It counts a person like me who has an enormous number of ties in Ghana and Nigeria from my work in those countries. And you end up discovering that actually it's very lumpy. that what's actually happening most of the time on Facebook, if you could really show it, is that Facebook's very, very good at connecting us with people who we are already very well connected with. And so the reason that I bring this up, the reason that I start here, is that I think we imagine that the internet does certain things. I think we imagine a great deal of the time that the internet is connecting us in ways that are sort of unprecedented, that are expanding and globalizing our horizons. And I want to question whether that's actually the case. And I want to question it not just because of the internet, but really the world of media as a whole. Because we're at this very strange, and for me, paradoxical time, which is that if you believe the case, and it's made, you know, in some sides by people as absurd as Thomas Friedman, and by more reasonable commentators as well, that economies are integrating, that we need to start thinking about issues on a global scale, we actually seem, at least in broadcast media, to be getting significantly less international news than we did even 30 or 40 years ago. And this was an analysis done by Elisa Miller of Public Radio International, of the percentage of international news in American television newscast, and you may immediately say, well, obviously, TV news. But TV news continues to be the way that most Americans end up getting their news. This is an incredibly relevant way of looking at where we're getting information, and it's possible that the amount of information about the rest of the world has been steadily shrinking since the end of the Vietnam War. Now, the good news on all of this is that, of course, we can get information from lots of different sources online. And a lot of those sources are vastly more globally focused. But what's interesting is that in many cases, not in the New York Times, actually, but in a whole lot of other major newspapers, we are also seeing them get more local in their focus. Wonderful study done by the Media Standards Trust in the UK that argues that the amount of foreign news in UK newspapers has shrunk by 45% over the last 30 years. We've been trying to replicate this over at Center for Civic Media. We ended up finding for three US newspapers over a 40-year period, we saw about a 40% shrinkage. We didn't for the New York Times. Thank goodness for the New York Times. But as you start getting into the digital media space, it turns out that in many cases, we may be actually getting more parochial and looking more and more towards our own borders. Here's the Huffington Post, which now at this point has a far greater reach in terms of online audience, maybe not as much prestige, but a larger audience than the New York Times. And HuffPo actually isn't all that bad. They're trying quite hard to expand their international coverage. They're adding international editions. But if you just look at the two of them sort of side by side, you can see pretty quickly that we are even more domestically focused in some of these digital media than we were in sort of eras of broadcast. And it turns out that the same thing may be happening in social media. This is a wonderful new paper out by Lutaro and a couple of other authors looking at where people are tweeting from and what Google News is talking about. So in white is where people are tweeting from. This is geolocation of a huge set of tweets. And you'll see there are some very heavily concentrated areas. Western Europe, Eastern United States, Japan, Korea, Malaysia. Malaysia turns out to be incredibly important on Twitter. The red dots are places that are showing up in Google News. And you're only seeing them in red because you're not seeing them on Twitter. So you can sort of think of the red there as places that we're still getting from the world of news, and we're not really getting anything from Twitter, at least. We might be getting it from other social media. There's other ways we might be getting that information. But it would be a mistake to conclude that we're going to be able to get the sort of global views, particularly from places like India, like sub-Saharan Africa, just by relying on the social media side of this. Why does any of this matter? It matters because the really interesting big problems these days are global in scale. If you want to go after an enormous issue like climate change, it's not going to be enough to persuade Americans to drive a different kind of car or to put solar panels on top of their house. At the end of the day, if you actually want to have an impact on this issue, you need to be talking to people in China, you need to be talking to people in India, you need to be talking to people in Nigeria, you need to be figuring out how people right now who are poor but moving into middle income can both have progress and growth, but not in the same way that the US had that path. This matters because some of the scariest threats are the threats that come out of a connected world. And whether you decide that you'd rather be frightened by epidemic or by terrorism, a lot of the threats that we look at these days are transnational, trans-border threats. We can look at something like the spread of SARS. We can look at the possibility, as we seem to be right now, that Islamic terrorists might be menacing all of us, and therefore all of our mail needs to be read to protect us from it. If we want to live in a world with this very high level of connection, one reason to pay attention to what we know and what we don't know is what we fear. But I'm going to argue that we actually have many more exciting things coming out of this connected world than negative things. These connections are potentially a source of threat. They're potentially the source of infection. They're also the source of inspiration. And for me, that's where this case for figuring out how to change what we're learning about the world and what we're hearing about the world comes into play. The danger is this. We tend to get goods from around the world. We tend to get people from around the world. We don't get information around the world. We've gotten very, very good at sharing atoms. We've gotten very, very good at moving people across borders. We are less good at moving bits across borders, which is crazy if you think about it, right? It's costless, it's weightless. There's really no difference in some real sense between me loading the New York Times and the Times of India. But for the most part, I'm not going to. We have really good data that suggests again and again that I'm not going to. And the reason for it is that at the end of the day, we human beings flock. We are subject to a tendency called homophily. It's incredibly well documented in social science that we tend to seek out people who are like us. There are experiments where students walk into computer labs and we'll watch how a student figures out how to sit in a half-full computer lab. And a student will find their way, if they've got long hair as I do, they'll find their way over to a long-haired person. And you ask them, you know, what are you doing? You know, someone who wears glasses will sit down with someone who wears glasses. And you ask them what they're doing, they'll say, well, that person looked nice. But somewhere is our talent for finding people who have the same socioeconomic background, the same racial background, the same belief system in one fashion or another. We're incredibly good at looking for our flock. And this tendency to flock was probably advantageous for us for most of human history. But we may be hitting this moment when we're in a world like this one where this tendency to flock is keeping us separated from information we need to have. Because we are so good at paying attention to those near and dear to us, because we're so good at paying attention to the other members of the flock, we may not be getting the view that we actually need of the world. My fear is that the tools that we're building for the internet aren't taking this very seriously. I think we've been building tools to solve some of our basic desires. Search is an amazing tool for desire. It basically says, what do you want? I'm going to do my very best to give it to you. I don't want to challenge you. I know that if that first link or two isn't right, you're going to run off. So I want to give you precisely what you want. I want to reduce the amount of risk in this equation. I want to get as precise as I possibly can. And my argument is that this may actually be dangerous. This may actually be bad for us. We may need to encounter a certain amount of cognitive diversity to really find ourselves getting the information and input that we need in the world. But we're going even further in the same direction, right? So we're now moving into a realm of social search, where not only am I getting what I want, but now I'm getting what my friends want. And there's lots of reasons to be creeped out by Facebook search. I mean, it is in fact really creepy, the fact that you can constitute a search for the bars liked by my female friends is really freaky. But for me, what's actually weird about it is I'm not sure that I want to have my friends pre-filtering for me. You could think of your friends potentially as an amazing source of inspiration if you're lucky enough to have a diverse set of friends that are pushing you in a bunch of different directions. But if we're subject to homophily, if we're encountering a lot of the same people again and again and again, The danger is these tools of social search may be driving us into these very, very small circles of the same content and the same ideas over and over again. Here's why I really care about this. This guy, Ronald Burt, wrote a wonderful paper some years back called Structural Holes in Good Ideas. Burt was in a position that social scientists love to be. He was inside a very powerful institution. He got himself hired as a vice president at Raytheon. And because he was VP at Raytheon, he was able to experiment on Raytheon employees. And the experiment that he did was he took the purchasing department and he solicited everybody in the purchasing department and basically said, tell me how you would make this company better. He got everybody to write down suggestions. He put them in front of the senior executives of the company and basically said, are these any good? And the senior executives went through all of them and said, here are the good ideas, here are lousy ideas, here are people who are just complaining. And then he correlated the results of that to the social network of people in the company. And what he found out was that people who were at certain places in this social network were, as he puts it, at high risk of having good ideas. If you found yourself as a bridge between two different parts of this network, if you were in charge of purchasing in Cleveland, but you also had to be in touch with the office in Cincinnati all the time, you had a much better chance of having good ideas than someone who worked only in Cleveland. And what he ends up suggesting for this is that creativity is an import-export business. Most of us do not sit in a blank room and think wonderful thoughts because we're contemplating the pureness of the surroundings around us and simply going to the platonic essence of our minds. Most of us are thieves. I know that I am. We look for inspirations in one culture and we try to figure out how to bring them across. And some thieves are really good at this. If you look at how Picasso comes up with cubism, it has a whole lot to do with masks that he's picking up from modern day Benin. It's that inversion of surfaces that ends up coming in and becomes part of the cubist vocabulary. And if you look through Picasso's studio, his move into cubism comes right after he starts collecting African masks, which, by the way, he did up until his death. You look at the studio right before he dies, and it's basically filled with these items. I'm really interested in how we can use the internet not to isolate ourselves, not just to see what our friends want us to see, but how to take advantage of this incredible cognitive diversity that's available from having access to people all over the world. And I actually want to do this. Like, I don't just want to argue about this. I actually want to think about how we build these things. We have an enormous problem right now in our dialogue about technology, which is a new technology comes along like Google Glass, and the assumption is, well, this is here now. We're going to have it. Let's think about how we deal with the world with Google Glass. Like, Google Glass is now mostly in the labs, and you've got people in bars basically banning people from wearing Google Glass in it, right? So we assume that it's going to come into play, and we try to figure out how we're going to react to it. There's another alternative to this. We could have a conversation and decide, do we want this or not? Do we want this technology to work the way we think or fear it's going to work? And what worries me a great deal of the time is when we talk about whether the internet is making us stupider or whether the internet is making us more polarized or whether it's making us fat or whether it's making us bald, we're not actually talking about the fact that this is a technology that most people didn't encounter 20 years ago. This is something that a lot of people in this room had a hand in building. If we do not like how the internet works, we can fix it. If we are worried that the internet is not giving us a diverse view of the world, and that is what I'm worried about, we can go after that problem. Now, this was my first stab at going after this problem. This is yet another Berkman project. One of the many things I got to do while housed at the Berkman Center was to try to go after this question of how we would find out what was going on in other parts of the world by looking at what other people were saying. And so Global Voices is now almost a 9-year-old project, about 1,200 people all over the world telling you what's going on in Gabon, what's going on in Ghana, what's going on in Germany. It's been a success up to a point. It's a very healthy community. It's a fun site. It might push you in some different directions. But you probably don't read it, and you know, honestly, I don't read it every day. And it's a real problem, because when we think about how we build tools to expose us to the rest of the world, we actually have to think about what we really do. How do we really find information? How do we actually come across this stuff? So I'm starting to think about this in a different way. That's a Fitbit. I carry one. This is not a good day for steps. I'm only at 7,400. But I think a lot of people right now are thinking about this question of how do you track your own behavior? I know that I don't read Global Voices very often because I've started tracking my own media behavior. I think it's crazy, by the way, that we've gotten so good at tracking our bodies, the steps we take, the sleep cycle we've gotten into, the food we eat, and we don't track our minds very often. We don't track what we're reading, what we're thinking about, who we're talking to. I'd like to get to the point where we're doing cognitive tracking, where we can really think about what we're encountering. And this is how I know that left to my own devices, I will spend my entire time reading cute cat macros on Reddit and reading about the Green Bay Packers, and that I actually have to have someone pushing me to try to encounter information that I might need but don't know that I need. And so we're starting to think about some of these things over at MIT Media Lab. This is a tool developed in part by Nathan Matias, who's in my lab, also by Sarah Slavitz, who's an amazing graphic designer. She's Twitter handle Dear Sarah. The tool is called Follow Bias. And the idea behind this is it's very simple. It's very straightforward. You go to followbias.com. You enter in your Twitter handle. It looks to see who you follow on Twitter. And it tries to automatically calculate just one variable, just the gender. How many women are you following? How many men are you following? In this case, how many brands or bots are you following? And this is the actual information for me. It turns out I follow about 1,100 people on Twitter, and they are mostly men. I follow comparatively few women. This is an embarrassing slide to put up, but this is not something that would have been very easy for me to find out had someone not built a tool to make it possible for me to look at this. And since I've been going out using this tool, when I follow someone on Twitter, I spend a lot of time thinking about whether I want to follow Dan Novi because, you know, he's another white dude. And like, do I really need more white dudes hanging out at the Media Lab? There's a lot of them in my life right now. Maybe I need to find someone else to sort of diversify my view. But until we have tools that let us ask questions about what we're seeing or not seeing, until we have tools that let us interrogate the media that we're looking at. This is something else we're doing at the Boston Globe. This is Catherine D'Ignazio's work. We're doing this with Boston Globe data to try to get a sense for what the Globe does and doesn't cover. And we've ended up finding out that there are large chunks of the city of Boston that actually have very few stories per capita, and that when you dig into what's going on in those stories per capita, you're often getting communities framed or presented in a very specific way. I think if we want to go after this question of what we're putting into our heads, if we want to get to a point where we're getting a high level of cognitive diversity, if we want to get to the point where we're encountering people from other countries and cultures, we really have to consciously go after these questions. We need to look at our behavior. We need to put lenses on the media that we end up encountering. Most of us do not have the luxury of hopping on an airplane and seeing the world directly. We are seeing the world through the lens of media. And if we want to think about how we're seeing that world, we have to think critically about how it's coming to us. We're hoping to get to the point where we're starting to build some proactive tools around this. This is one of the tools that we're starting to think about building at the Media Lab called the Weekly Different, which is something that would look at how you behave on Twitter and essentially say, hey, you're following a lot of these same people. Can I push you out of your comfort zone? Maybe not a 180. Maybe we're not going to have me, you know, following evangelical Christians from Uganda who believe that homosexuals are the devil. Maybe we can find someone who's a New England progressive leftist who happens to be a strong person of faith, which actually would be a challenge for me and getting me a little bit out of my comfort zone. Maybe we can move people 5 degrees or 10 degrees. But one way or another, if we're interested in this question of what we're getting and what we're not getting, I think it's incumbent on us not to be satisfied with the limits or the problems of the tools that we have in front of us right now when we do have this opportunity to sort of pick these things up and figure out a way to rewire them. So that's the basic idea behind the book. The good news is that there's other ideas in the book. These lovely three people, who I'm going to welcome to the stage, have had the chance to read and offer some reactions. And can I welcome David, Judith, and Emery?
That was really you.
That works.
So look out, ball's coming. It's a party. We're going to begin with Judith Doneth, a wonderful faculty fellow from the Berkman Center, to take us away, and then we'll have Anne Marie, curator of the Nieman Foundation, and then David Weinberger from the Harvard Libraries and Berkman Center.
Hello. Thank you, Ethan. That was wonderful. There's only one point I really want to argue with you about, which was when you started. Everything else is going to be much more nuanced. When you started by saying that it was an imposition to have to read this book, or any book. And I think the other side of books is that many books are actually a gift. They give you hours of time that's fascinating. You read stories you would have never thought of. They provoke you to think about things you had not thought of before, and this book certainly falls into that category of something that's far more, far more like a gift than an imposition, and I certainly enjoyed all the time I spent reading it. Part of it was the stories are, it's full of anecdotes, they're fascinating, Ethan is an amazing storyteller, and he manages to make a very deep and complicated and very nuanced argument. I mean, that's one of the things that also sets this book apart, is that so many books are themselves not examples of diversity. And Ethan's thinking is internally diverse. It's not about saying, we must do this, we must all be global, it's really great, the web is this, it's making us more diverse, or it's keeping us from being diverse, or that diversity is always good. So part of the complexity of reading it is that he is a writer who will say, but, a lot. He goes back and forth with ideas. So you're reading a mind arguing with itself, but through extraordinarily entertaining stories. And so part of it was, in the reading, I spent a lot of time arguing in my head about this. I have a tendency to be very like, no, you're wrong. And so part of it was the initial question about, well, why at heart do we really want this type of diversity? What is the value of being global like that? And partly from being in the book club with Ethan, there are ideas that we have started talking about and that I've written in different directions. So I want to take a couple of those pieces and argue them out with you. And one of the things that is fascinating about a story like this is we are living in a really, really complicated time. I think probably most people who are alive think their times are complicated, but ours, partly because of massive technological change, globalization, et cetera, is very complex. I have a 12-year-old who keeps asking me, she says, in the 60s, everyone wore micro miniskirts, and it was very psychedelic. And what is it that characterizes our time now? And if you read things like Vogue, they say this is a very complicated time to get a grasp, even on style, because it changes, and there's so many subcultures. There's not a single dominant way of thinking or dressing the way that you could have seen even a few decades ago. But when we look at the types of change that we're living in, one around these issues around the social networks is a really fascinating one, to look at the changes that technology is bringing and the challenges that Ethan is bringing out about saying, what actually do we want to be building? We can be changing our tools. We don't necessarily want to say that Facebook and Twitter are the be-all and end-all of technological aids to social networks, but what are our connections for today? And one of the interesting things, if you look maybe 150 years ago, people needed very, very, very strong ties. And in the world of social network analysis, a strong tie is someone you spend a lot of time with, you may have multiple ties with them, you have many, many friends in common, you spend a lot of time with them. And at a time when you weren't getting everything from a market, when all of your food and your home, you relied on friends to build it. How many of you have read The Little House in the Big Woods series? Yeah, so maybe about a quarter of them. It's a story about what it was like to grow up in pioneer days in America. It's mostly nonfiction. And one of the things that's remarkable about it is the level of self-sufficiency that people needed, you know, not that long ago. If you wanted a house, you needed to have people who would come who liked you enough to help you do this, and they would depend on you back and forth. So fast forward to today, we live in an era where all of those things, not just building your house, I mean, almost none of us have built our own house, but getting food, everything has been outsourced to a market. So we don't need that kind of strong tie. One of the things that's nice about not needing strong ties is that in a world where you can have more weaker ties, people you spend less time with, they can be more diverse. If you rely on a small set of close friends and family, you share all the information together, you're probably not that different. You need, in order to have a very diverse network, you're probably going to have a lot more very much weaker ties that aren't going to come and spend 2 days building a house with you. Maybe they'll have a beer with you. And so one of the things you see today is people have many more weak ties. Now, if you look at the type of ties that you see online, they're extremely weak ties. There's the notion of the Facebook friend, who is someone you maybe met at a conference and you kind of like them. You may never see them again, but your friend's on Facebook and now you know something about who their kids are, et cetera. And we're having a growing connect set of these. Kids who are growing up today, when they go off to college, aren't going to leave behind the person they sat next to in first grade. They'll probably always be Facebook friends or whatever the equivalent is. You'll never lose them, but they're certainly not someone you'll rely on. So we're growing into a world where you can have a huge number of extremely weak ties. But what's remarkable is that's at a time when our need for connection is much smaller than it has ever been in history. Not only has the house building and the food sourcing been outsourced to the market, but huge amounts of things like personal care have been outsourced. We don't need to have a friend babysit for us. You can hire a babysitter. You could search for babysitters online. You know, I have kids. I found their babysitters through Sitter City. I didn't even have to, you know, if you move into a new neighborhood, you no longer need to actually meet other people who will tell you who are the reliable teenagers. You can find that information out online. So almost everything that we have relied on other people for, we are increasingly finding commercial or net or online solutions to. And so it's not so much that we don't like having people as much. We enjoy going out, we enjoy having friends. But the things that forced you to get out and make friends and the things that forced you to have ties with them are really disappearing from our world. And so all of our ties with other people are becoming increasingly volitional, which is nice. They can be very diverse. We can have this choice. But when faced with maybe being shy, maybe instead of making that friend in a new neighborhood, we can just look it up. So the forcing function on personal ties is much, much less than it's been before. So when we look at issues around these questions around global connectivity that Ethan is raising here, it's not necessarily just an issue of being global. It's an entire question of in our current technological, market-driven world, how do we get people to pay attention to others at any scale? And also, the other question that I've sort of debated a lot in my head in reading Ethan's book is that question, and Ethan raises it in a very interesting way, going back and forth between global as being international, but a lot of other questions around diversity. You know, even if you look at this issue of like, how many women are you following? If Ethan said, I've really boosted all the women that I'm reading, I am now following 75%, you know, wine drinking mommy bloggers, it might not actually be that diverse. You know, the range of ideas there might be relatively small. And so a lot of the other question is to really think about, what does it mean to make diverse ties with other people? And that's one of the really hard pieces, is developing the tools that help us find that connection with another person that lets you care enough about them at that kind of easy level of developing a relationship that then becomes something that ties you over in a longer span. And so I think a lot of it, a lot of what's interesting in our era, and this will be my last point, I'll move on. I had two friends who came out with books basically simultaneously this spring. One is Ethan with Rewire about the nature of globalization. They were both, to some extent, about our relationship with news. And the other was a woman named Nancy Jo Sales, whose book The Bling Ring had just come out. And it's a very, very different book about our relationship to news and what draws us into it. For those who haven't read about the Sofia Coppola movie, The Bling Ring is about a group of teenagers in Los Angeles who became so celebrity obsessed, they started breaking into the homes of celebrities. They broke into Paris Hilton's house, they broke into a lot of other celebrities' house, and just started stealing objects from them. And they would like start wearing their clothes, and sometimes they'd break into their houses multiple times, and they just felt such familiarity with these celebrity figures that they sort of kind of moved into their homes and started taking little pieces of their lives to feel like it. It's a terribly perverse version of having met another person through online journalism, but in some ways it's a total success story. They really deeply cared about them. So we want to kind of tune it down from that extreme, but to really understand what it is that in our era of meeting people through online stories, through online journalism, through all these different pieces, how do we make those kinds of connections that lets us see them as individuals, care about them deeply enough to want to make a further connection, and perhaps not actually break into their house, but become, take a little piece of their world and make it our own. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Because I'm going to be thinking about that for the next several weeks. Thinking about a couple of chapters that I wish I could revise at this point. But I wanted to react to one piece where I feel like you're spot on, which is this idea that, yeah, sorry about that, I'm pretty loud.
All right, now I'm louder. So this idea that as we move to markets to meet our needs, we need fewer and fewer strong ties. I think that's really astute. And I think it's worth asking this question, what sort of ties do we need now? In many ways, sort of social search essentially says, as long as you've got this network of very, very weak ties, you can get recommendations, you can figure out how to navigate the world, we know you by your posse. And so as long as we know a little bit about them, we'll be able to recommend to you, we'll be able to filter you to the right babysitter, so on and so forth. And I think the case that I'm trying to make, and someone was tweeting that basically we can't go a single event here at the Berkman Center without mentioning Granovetter, but one of the things that I tried to look at in this book was going back to Mark Granovetter's The Strength of Weak Ties and looking at this idea of the bridge tie. And the bridge tie is someone who's tying you into a different part of your social network, much as Ron Burt is talking about these figures within organizations who are at structural holes. But I think what's really important as we start becoming dependent on markets is that we're becoming dependent on sets of people who we don't know and often don't understand. And it may be that we're fine with that, or it may be that it puts us in this very fragile place in life where we don't understand the needs and wants of the others who we're depending on for, in some cases, our very basic needs. And bridge ties sort of suggest the possibility that perhaps we can find some people on our network who can push us in a different direction and help us sort of understand what's going on mm-hmm. from that perspective.
So I'll have one quickly.
It's going
to be very super quick.
Audience to answer.
Absolutely super quick. But
tweet length.
Yes. The strength of weak ties, the ties have strength because they're diverse, not because they are weak. And one of the great things that social media are doing now are helping us find the elements in our weak ties that we wouldn't have known about, but are multiple things we have in common. And a lot of what's important is in making ties strong is their multiplexity, that it gives us the ability to discover that a person we thought we knew slightly, we actually have many more things in common than polite conversation had let us know.
Thank you.
Two tweets. Six tweets, sorry.
So I wanted to start where Ethan's book begins, which is actually a dedication to his young son. For Drew, he writes, who will grow up in a world as wide as his dreams. So I began with my daughter, a teenager, and a day not very long ago when I glimpsed her working at her laptop and noted a very striking screensaver. It was a photo taken in 1979, which was 15 years before she was born, and it's of a volleyball game between Mexican and U.S. citizens. But this game was unusual in that each team was physically planted in its own country. The Mexicans in NACO, Mexico, and the Americans in NACO, Arizona. Dressed in their street clothes and cowboy hats and using as their volleyball net a rusted border fence that divided their countries. It's a very beautiful and provocative image. And I haven't thought about that photo in a long while, but couldn't stop thinking about it as I was reading Rewire, Ethan's very powerful book. So I came back to it as a sort of visual metaphor for both the promise and the barriers in the age of connection that, for me, you were so brilliantly describing. So hardwired for humanity and curiosity, and relatively recently equipped with the technology to reach more widely and act more readily on both, we still face the equivalent of these border fences in many of our daily interactions. And so my reactions to the book and a few things I wanted to talk about today are formed as a near reaction as a near lifelong journalist trying very hard, who spent many years trying very hard to overcome the flock tendencies that Ethan articulates in Rewire. So first, language and culture can be alienating without what Ethan calls these bridge bloggers or bridge builders to connect us across the divide. And there are many, many divides without such bridge builders. The Arab Spring was an exception. And the chances that we will encounter these moments, moments like that, stories just as important, are meaningfully fewer with a diminished journalistic core. I dislike sports metaphors, but allow me one. So thinking about this volleyball photograph, ideas by the multitude are spiked over the net every moment. I don't know what's going on in the Twitter screen behind me, but I'm sure it's full of brilliance. But not all of these ideas find their way into play. Think of your own experience with publishing, whether it be a book or a tweet. Authors are often as surprised by their successes as by their failures, for the reason that tastes and interests are more vicissitudinous than immutable. We don't know what connects. We guess at what connects. Time is finite. In searching to recover the NACO volleyball photo this week, I scraped the surface of a whole wonderful world of immigration law, of drug weapons and people running, of the scene of the longest sustained battle of the Mexican Revolution, which I didn't know, of a courageous local newspaper, El Mirador, which has exposed corruption at a local orphanage I'd never heard of, and the construction of metal walls along sections of this border, which may have signaled the end of the local volleyball game. I say may because I did not have time this week to further press the issue, as perhaps my daughter did not while studying for the ACT and the SAT and taking high school final exams and volunteering on a political campaign and doing some local community service, which brings me to empathy. Empathy is not infinitely elastic. I love what Ethan's book and what Ethan himself demands of us, of himself and others, and wish we were all the better angels he seeks in the world. But it's possible that our current technological ability to connect outpaces our empathic capacities. In her very important book, Talking to Strangers, Anxieties of Citizenship Since Brown versus Board of Ed, Danielle Allen reminds us of the advice that we give to children, that we have all given to children, and that is true across classes and race. Don't talk to strangers. Danielle identifies this taught suspicion of others as a foundation of our civic education and argues that we should substitute it with what she calls a citizenship of political friendship. I think Danielle and Ethan are effectively and compassionately arguing for something similar, but both against some historic habits and redoubts that require generational change, not merely technological possibility. And as the one so-called mainstream media representative here, let me say one more thing about the beleaguered MSM. In Rewire, Ethan correctly underscores the serious decline in the number of foreign correspondents writing for U.S. newspapers, a trend that roughly mirrors my own personal experience. When I left the Chicago Tribune as editor 5 years ago, we had about a dozen foreign bureaus. Today, there are none. And the paper is relying for a much smaller foreign report on the Los Angeles Times and others. Ethan writes, quote, fewer dedicated correspondents doesn't necessarily mean less international coverage in U.S. newspapers, but I think the evidence to the contrary is abundant. A corollary to the diminished staff of correspondents is the disappearing staff of editors thinking and worrying about and studying the world each day, searching for news across the oceans and for ways to connect it to their readers. If Ethan is right, and I think he is, about homophily, love of same, literally, and our tendency to seek out and embrace people like ourselves, then that loss of journalists who intuitively understood that and spent their days looking to interest us in and connect us to people unlike ourselves comes at a particularly cruel time, just as our ability to connect with so many unlike us has never been greater. And this is true locally, too. It's not just a foreign story. When I think of where my daughter sat in Hyde Park in her home in Chicago, looking at this photograph, and two blocks from her was the Obama household, and seven blocks south of them, one of the poorest communities in the nation, Woodlawn, the divide that the Midway Plaisance, 59th Street at the University of Chicago, the divide that that represents between knowledge and empathy is huge. The internet's celebrated virtue in enabling us to create and edit our own daily we is in stark institutional contrast to a newspaper's historic job as the daily we. There are some and many good reasons that model has faltered, but it's possible that it's a collateral casualty of what Ethan most seeks, that which he, in his closing paragraph, calls a world that values diversity of perspective over the certainty of singular belief.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for putting empathy on the table. This book took me a long time to write, probably 5 years of actually writing it, and 7 or 8 years of picking arguments and fights with people, because that's what we do at the Berkman Center. And I spent the first 2 or 3 years picking fights with journalists, because I assumed that it was the MSM's fault. And that this decline in international coverage was pointing towards a market tendency in journalism that was trying to cover what was easier to cover, what audiences wanted, trying to give people precisely what they wanted. And one of the things that's become clearer over time is realizing to what extent journalism, or at least quality journalism, is about engineering empathy. And I talk a little bit about engineering serendipity in the book and helping people sort of stumble on the unexpected bit of information that they need. But empathy is stumbling upon the emotion that connects you to someone that you wouldn't otherwise be connected with. So I'm very, very grateful for that.
And I would add that connects them back to you in some meaningful way. I was thinking, as I was preparing for tonight, about you know, some long ago dreaded focus group I sat in when I was at the newspaper, and a gentleman describing a very particular story and how he had, this was in the late 90s, and there was the crisis with the Thai baht, which caused a horrible economic ripple. And he was explaining how he, in a suburb of Chicago, was made to understand why that mattered to him. That with 401ks and diversified investments and the rest of it, this now mattered. So I was making notes on that to myself today, and it was interesting that the iPad kept correcting bot to bat. So, like, why am I even using this word? But it wasn't just accidental that he discovers that. It takes, it's not pure empathy. It's maybe sympathy based on some self-interest, right? Yep. But it takes somebody to make that connection to that person and your own interests. And that's not a bad thing.
Yep.
It's actually a skill.
David?
So I want to echo Judith's, you're being ridiculous about the imposition thing. Let's just start there. So we get to spend 10 to 15 hours with you in a book. And I can't imagine anything better than that, except having gotten to spend 10 years with you. I've learned more from you than I have learned from anybody. So thank you. It's a wonderful book. And I think you got a taste of that here. It's a book from Ethan's head and from his heart and from his wide experience. Let me just give you one example of, so you talked a little bit tonight about, it turns out we are better at moving atoms around the world than moving bits. So this is a wonderful eye-opening point. It's in the very first chapter, and the way that Ethan makes the point in the book, where he has a little more time, is to take us through the story of Fiji water and why we're better able to get water moved around the globe than information about what's going on in Fiji. And I won't ask for a show of hands, but I'm quite certain that all of us, most of us, certainly me, have drunk more Fiji water than we've drunk Fiji bits. It's a wonderful way of making the point, and the book is just full. This is how Ethan's thought, and very much like your point, the back and forth, your ability to question yourself and to think more than one thought at a time. It's just a wonderful book. So in the book, Ethan makes a number of assumptions, which I think I'm not going to challenge at all. They're important and right. The first is that technology does not determine how we take it up. If it did, then it would be settled. We wouldn't be looking for new ways of doing it. And if it were as good as many of us were hoping it would be, and as determinate as some of us thought it would be, then we would not have the very issue that Ethan is pointing to. This is not techno-determinism. It's the opposite. It's totally removed from it. If anything, it's techno-opportunism. That the internet presents us with an opportunity, and we have not seized it. And Ethan makes that point through data and stories in a way that nobody else has. Second assumption that he makes is that we're situated, that we only understand the world from a point of view. That point of view is deep, deep in our culture, in our language, that this is not a failure, it is a necessity. It's the only way we can understand things is from a point of view, from a cultural point of view, and that in fact it's so far from being simply a grinding necessity that it's a source of joy. It also, for Ethan, implies a type of what's used to be called anyway, pluralism, an appreciation of other cultures, that there isn't one right culture, that our culture is not the right one, and so it also entails a type of humility, a very, very welcome humility, which is certainly characteristic of how Ethan approaches this very rich and diverse world. And the third assumption is that we are, as a people and as a species, we are creatures that care, that we are interested, because if we weren't, then the question of why we have not flocked, so to speak, to information from around the world, to the cultures of the world, then that question would be very easily answered. Because we're selfish bastards and we don't care. We're just all wrapped up. So for all the homophily, the challenge of the book, which is profound, which is as important a question as has been raised about the internet, is rooted in the sense that, in fact, we do care. So I want to talk just a little bit about one of the issues, and it's one that you and I have, because I'm struggling. I'm trying to find something I disagree with, and I'm not really having a tough time. So serendipity, something that...
Please, yes. We definitely differ on this one.
Well,
yes.
We do, but if we did, you won. I think you're basically right. But I'm going to try to find a shade of difference, okay? So in the chapter on serendipity, which is one of the really wonderful chapters in the book, Ethan's question is that it's actually an assumption that we would be interested if, in the rest of the world, if, dot, dot, dot. And so that subjunctive, that conditional, that would, I think, really powers most of the book. And in many ways, it's a political would, it's a political imperative, it's a moral imperative. It has to do with empathy as well. So we would be interested in all the sorts of things that we're not interested in. If only what? And so in the serendipity chapter, which is a rich chapter, I can't possibly summarize it, but part of what Ethan says is he salutes Jane Jacobs and points to a city as a place in which serendipity happens, at its best it happens, and points to her idea of designing to minimize isolation or designing to engineer encounters and engagement. To which Ethan then adds Robert Merton on the topic and says, well, it's not enough just to run into people at the crossroads, at the social holes. You also have to have an open mind, which is a really important point as well. And so that's obviously a big part of the solution. And the book has other large themes about how we can make progress here. I'm certainly in favor of structuring serendipity. But I'm not as convinced that it's going to do the job or that it's actually addressing the root of it. So you've talked tonight, and certainly in the book, a great deal about the importance of bridge figures, people who help us see, find what's of value in another culture. And tonight you actually, and in the book, you talked about it in terms of desire, which actually helped crystallize for me what my... maybe difference is, because it's certainly important that we cultivate our desires and that education is a way of doing that. A good education cultivates your desires. But desire is only, at most, it's half of the equation. The other half is that interest is something that doesn't happen in us. Desire is something that we do, or you know, is in us, but interest is something that calls out from the world. We get interested in things that we had no idea we were interested in. I had no idea I was interested in sumo. I couldn't be less. I have no interest in sports, and within the hierarchy of sports, I'm going to say sumo pretty much at the bottom. So I had no idea that I had no desire to know about sumo until I heard Ethan. Unexpectedly, I was thrown into a room. Ethan's giving a talk on sumo. He cares a great deal about sumo and made it interesting. So here you were the bridge, as you've been for so many of us in so many different ways. You were the bridge to sumo, which I have to say I don't have that much interest in, but I had more than before I heard you talk. this was the world calling out to me. It was not a desire. And so it's not, in addition to structuring serendipity, structured serendipity will look like noise, will look like a distraction. Why is Google giving me all these results I don't care about? Why is Facebook larding up my page with things I don't care about? I don't care about the sumo results. I don't care about the Brazilian, you know. It will just look like noise unless there is something in it that is interesting. One of the things is empathy, but we don't get to empathy until somebody writes really, really well, or is Anthony Bourdain and is doing the TV show, where he's not an expert in the many cultures he goes to, but he does a fantastic job of getting us interested in cultures we did not know were interesting. So part of it, of course, is cultivating desire, but part of it also, and part of it is structuring serendipity, but the serendipity won't work unless the thing that we stumble across has this certain artistic, I don't know what to say, the quality of great journalism, the quality of a fantastic New Yorker article or a wonderful Anthony Bourdain show or your book or most of what you talk about and educate us on, because we need more Anthony Bourdains, we need more Paul Simons, and we need many, many more Ethans. And the problem is that we can't have many more Ethans because there's really only one. You combine such a unique set of talents and desires and interests and loves. So thank you so much for your 10 to 15 hour gift.
If I had not already turned several shades of red, I would have moved into new depths of crimson. Let me fill you in on the argument here, because I think it is actually an interesting argument. By the end of the book, I end up saying, look, we can try to get you more perspectives from the rest of the world, we can translate for you, we can introduce you to bridge figures, but ultimately, what we don't have a lot of control over is desire. If you want to hear only about the Green Bay Packers, the internet makes it really easy to hear about the Green Bay Packers. And the worry is that we don't always want to know what we want to know. We sometimes need to know something that we didn't know we needed to know. And the fact that that's such a convoluted sentence, you know, helps explain it's an extremely tough concept to get around. But we need to encounter information that's unfamiliar, that's challenging. Sometimes we need it because it's critical information about the world. Sometimes we need it because it has that hidden inspiration which allows us to move in a different direction. And so I end up proposing that we've gone from a world where most media is very heavily curated, and this is sort of the tendency in mainstream media of saying, let me give you a very diverse view of what's out there, to a world of search where we choose what we want, to a world of social where we choose and are informed by our circle of friends. And I'm wondering whether the next step in all of this is serendipity. And my hope is that we could get very, very good at looking at what you know and what you've encountered and then taking you somewhere out of those ruts. And David, I think, is sympathetic up to the point where I start saying, now I'm going to start giving you an article on sumo because you don't know much about sumo, but it's close enough to your profile that I'm going to push you a little bit out of your comfort zone, and maybe you'll have this unexpected discovery. And David, as an artist, a brilliant writer, someone who quite literally taught me how to write, not in the sense that if you don't like the book that it's his fault, but that if it comes off well, I have learned an enormous amount from this man on how to write a book. David takes very seriously the craft aspect of all of this. And I think that's right. And I think in some ways the word engineering may be where we're getting tripped up on all of this. When someone writes a beautiful article in The Atlantic or The Utney Reader or The New Yorker or pick whatever outlet you want for beautiful writing, I think that can be a form of engineering serendipity. It's a way of saying, I want to pull you onto a topic or onto a subject that you otherwise wouldn't explore. But I think we can go in other directions as well. I think one of the amazing things about this participatory moment in time is that so much is being created and so much is being generated that we may be able to do as much with guiding people in different directions as we are in creating new directions to go in. But it's wonderful to have these arguments, and this is why you have to keep friends in your life who you can always argue with on an open topic.
I completely agree with that. So.
This is the weakest.
How's the argument then?
This is the weakest argument I've ever seen. But so with those fabulous comments to kick us off, we just have a few minutes left. We want to be out of here by 7:30 because one of these walls is going to magically rise and reveal drinks and snacks for y'all. But I want to open it up to the audience for questions or comments. There's been a really rich Twitter stream. We have a couple of mics here. I will invite you to be short in your comments because we don't have much time. Dan, you have a mic? To be super brief, we're going to take three or four at once, and then one up here in front. And as Ethan likes to say, remember that your question ends with an interrogative, perhaps a rising voice or a question mark if it's written. So, sir.
Let me try.
Questions, not statements. Quick. I'm going to be tough. Oh, come on. All right.
Ethan, this is a question for you. You said something, you said if we didn't like the way the internet is, we could change it. And you specifically used the example of Google glasses. Who would we be? How would we decide what we were doing? And how on earth would you possibly change it?
We'll take a couple of these and then we'll accumulate. Laura.
I'll hold up my sticker from Stanford D School that says empathy happens. Does empathy happen from the process of the people creating the interaction or from the audience?
Where's the other mic? Marcelo?
Hi, Are you not being very American-centric? I am from Brazil, professor, sorry about that. I just downloaded the book. I didn't read it yet. But I feel from the debate that this is a very American perspective. What social media and all this has done in other countries that is not US has brought a diverse view, much more diverse view, and not a contracting view.
One more. Carrie, you have it?
I'm kind of curious about power. It seems that some of the serendipity engineering kind of assumes a sort of beforehand knowledge about what's good for us or when a new connection needs to be made. So how do we get a gatekeeper that can be trusted with that power and is benevolent and not going to lead us down a bad place? Also, cognitive tracking scares the hell out of me.
There you go, Ethan.
For little questions, that'll be easy.
Those will be quick.
Look, on Google Glass, let me give you two answers to how we could go after it if we didn't like where it was going. There's an engineering we and there's a political we, right? So some of the book is written for an engineering we that sort of says, if you don't like the biases in these tools, if you don't like the idea that we're being pushed towards, find out what your neighbor's like, try to figure out how you push towards people who are very different from you and try to build systems that push you in very different ways. But I would say on Google Glass specifically, the more powerful we is probably the we that sort of says, maybe we don't like the policy implications of this, maybe we don't like having this out in the public. In the US, we've done a very poor job of defending privacy rights. This is what we're bumping into with the NSA at the moment. Europeans have reacted to Google Maps very differently than we have. And they've gone and sued Google in Germany and essentially said, you have to have the right to blur it out. There are different reactions in different... Reverse today in Germany. Didn't know that. There are certainly stronger protections for privacy in the EU than there are in the US. I would say legal protection within France and Germany is significantly stronger for privacy than in the US. Not an expert on international law, but there are probably a few folks in the room who might be able to back me up on this one. Generally speaking, when you have debates about privacy, you have people trying to come from an EU perspective because they have a different legislative point on it. My only point on this is that it doesn't have to be inevitable. Different societies react to technologies in different ways. And some have gone after and tried to say, just because you can do this technologically doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to do this politically. I'm gonna leave Laura's question, which is awesome, but there's no way that I can go after it. I'm gonna go after Marcelo's question and basically say, look, I hope not. I mean, I hope I have not written a miserably Americentric book. What I end up finding in a lot of the research that I quote on this is that actually everyone's pretty parochial, and that I suspect that if you do a deep dive, you may find that this tendency to connect to the local is pretty strong in Brazil as well. And I say that with a reasonable amount of confidence because I did do the research on what Brazilians are reading when they're reading news and discovered the same sort of domestic biases that we saw in other places, and also in looking at the work that we did with Facebook at what percentage of the ties are made locally. And generally speaking, what we've seen a huge amount of in Brazilian social media is actually what we've seen in the US, which is basically as people who are moving and going to university, they're keeping those ties at home. So they're starting to have that sort of secondary or tertiary set of ties. And in fact, in many ways, there's a lot of Brazil in the book, and I hope you read it, because one of the things that comes out is the sense in which what goes on in some of those other conversations can be sort of incomprehensible if you're not within it. So actually, a lot of the book wrestles with Cala Boca Galvao, and suddenly the rest of the world looking in at a Brazilian-only conversation, and then the Brazilians responding by basically saying, let us make fun of the fact that you're monolingual Americans. So I hope when you actually get into it, it may be slightly less Americentric than we are at this point. The question of power is a phenomenal question. And look, my thinking behind building systems to track is that it's a really big difference between me tracking the steps that I take during the day and my health insurance company tracking the steps that I take during the day. And when I'm tracking the number of steps that I take during the day, it's a helpful thing for me to sort of say, I'm going to walk back to my hotel this evening because it has not been a very physical day. Whereas if my insurance company is doing it and jacking up my premium after the fact, that's a very different thing. And I think part of what's gone on is that we've had this huge tendency to build sort of centralized services and centralized databases that I do think we want to reconsider and sort of ask questions about. Cognitive tracking is already going on. You're being tracked by Google in a very real way, trying to figure out who you are. And the question for me becomes, are there extents to which it makes sense to track yourself and try to figure out your own behavior? Is that something that we only want to give over to the advertisers? So it freaks me out too, but it freaks me out less if I can figure out how to take the tools and use them for myself. But you're absolutely right that there's an enormous amount of power with the maker of the algorithms, and that's in many ways sort of who I'm writing the book for, is to sort of say, look, you have more power in making algorithms than you think. Here's a blind spot that I think a lot of us have when we consider the internet. I think we assume that it tends to put us in this global direction, although I think in many cases the research puts us in a different direction. Can we examine how our algorithms end up reinforcing that in one fashion or another? It's 3 for 4. Laura knows that I'll actually have that conversation with her face to face.
So I want to invite you all, if you have any final thought, last word, last question, reflection? Good? No obligation?
Can I just stop by thanking you all again just for coming and for listening, and to thank everyone at the Berkman Center for putting this together, to thank my friends for taking the time to read closely and react. To thank Amar Asher and everybody else who helped put this together. This is just an enormous privilege for me, and thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it.